for the last session of the last day, thank you for being so nice and coming to hear me. Is it okay if we do this in English? I can do questions in other languages afterwards if we want. It's no problem. Several. So, I don't know, are we recording yet? Yes, we are. All right, so we could stop pretending. And do we basically have how long? 45 minutes. Can you tell me when a half an hour is done, when I have 15 minutes left? Especially, thank you. So, hey, hello. Welcome to Cologne in crazy weather. Just as my name, Jeffrey McGuire, says, ich bin Kölner. Ich komme aus Neppes. Who else is from Cologne here? Oh, nice. Cool. So, no more local jokes. Fine. One of the organizers was telling me very kindly, I saw that this conference was going to be in Cologne. I've had almost nothing to do with Java in my life and my career, but I saw the conference was here. I do live 10 minutes away. I thought, boy, I'd sure like to come and meet this community a little bit. Now, I do a lot of presenting and work in other technologies, and so I'm very curious to see what happens with this, and I'm very flattered that you came. Thank you very much. I think that probably the easiest way to get started is to tell you a little bit about what my company does, and that's also part of my origin story. And then I'd like to know, as we get started, how many of you are developers? How many of you are not developers? You can admit it. It's okay. So I'm a marketer, but I came out of the development side in the 2000s. Oof. And I found a little open source project called Drupal, which is a PHP CMS, and it's still around and doing very well for itself. I ended up getting a job at a startup in 2008 in engineering. And I was the most junior person in engineering, and I was writing documentation and doing testing and doing upgrade guides and really fun stuff like that. And because the company was in the US and I was over here, I started going to more and more events, and then people in my company thought, oh, you know people, go and do more events. And so in about 2011, I got moved into marketing, and I was the community manager, and I had a sponsorship budget. And got to go to more events, and I was learning that. So I'm a language guy, I'm a translator, I'm a writer, I'm a journalist a bit, and documentation is like the hardest, worst training classroom in the world, because you figure out what's hard for you to do, and then you write about it, and you hope someone else understands how you write, because you're always throwing it over the wall, and it was really frustrating. Then I got to come and speak with people about stuff, and I got more feedback. And over time, I saw a lot of tech marketing that I thought was sort of terrible. And how many people, oh wait, are there salespeople here apart from me? Okay, so. Oh, okay, all right, so. I wonder if you're familiar with a situation where the sales team from wherever you are has sold something that you don't actually build, or an Amazon instance that doesn't actually exist. Does that sound familiar at all? Yeah, you can say it. Nobody else is looking. And I ran into a whole bunch of those things, and I really, really, really hated that. And I also had writer's block, and so I learned to create content in a structured way and in a repeatable way by asking the people who build it questions, right? And most developers, if you ask them, hey, what is it that you're building and what's the coolest thing about it, most of you will tell me about that all day, right? And then I have the actual technical truth about the product, and I can go and create content that is true, and if I'm good at my job at writing, then it's also interesting, and I've saved you a bunch of time, right? So, fast forward to 2017, I left the startup when there was like 900 of us, and I met my business partner, who is an MBA and a strategist and an actual educated person. She has an MBA and education. I've had 2,000 or 3,000 beers with people just like you. That's my training. So what we say is, look, you you have to have empathy for for the people you're communicating with. You have to use language that they care about. You have to put things in a context that they care about. You have to be clear and honest. And I come from an open source background, and I really, really think telling more and sharing more and being more honest is my default, and I think it works for me. So I tell my clients, if you can't do a thing and it's not on your roadmap, don't pretend. Say you don't do it, because if someone's self-qualifying whether to give you a call or not and you are never going to be right for them, don't make them angry. Don't waste their time. Like, it's okay. They can go somewhere else. Somebody else is coming. And if we're empathic and communicate well and we're clear about what we do, then we can build trust with people, right? And trust equals a conversion, a download, a trial, a demo, a sale, something, right? So that's where Open Strategy Partners comes from. So we strategize with our clients. We want to understand where you are and where you're going. We do all the digital marketing stuff and campaigns and planning. We create a lot of content. We're a words first company. We write a lot and we're very systematic about it. We also do audio, video, other things. And I really want to help people, so we do workshops and training and give away our templates and talk about what we do as much as we can when we have time and success enough to do so. So that's my business partner, Tracy. I know it's obvious, but one thing is not obvious from this photo. Tracy is an absolute genius, and it's incredible to work with someone like her. But the obvious part is I'm the pretty one, which is why I get to go on the road and talk with people. Now, this is the sort of marketing that we don't do, right? And we don't do buzzword bingo, and we're not, you know, picking up the latest buzzwords and so on. And we, you know, this is part of the world that I come from that I really, really don't like. As I was explaining to you before, if we're empathic and clear, then we think we can build trust, right? And our framework says that we can make tech content that is compelling and technically accurate, which is the sweet spot for smart people like you who know what they're doing. This is a dumb example, okay? This is a dumb example. But if you read somewhere where someone doesn't understand the difference between Java and JavaScript, how much further are you going to read? Right? And how are you going to come back? You're not, right? We have to be very careful to be technically accurate in technology marketing. So when we've built a product-like thing, and that can also be a service offering, this is focused on products. We can also make this sort of a ladder for an open source product where there's no sale, but you know, you want someone to contribute or something like that. People have to be aware of what you're doing. You have to gain their interest. They're going to look at it and see if it's right for them. They'll try it if they think so. And then they'll take that final step of adopting it or not. So these are the sort of things where we're thinking, okay, buyer's journey, testing, like what kind of content, can we do what sort of, all of that marketing stuff is what we're thinking about. So you might say, the first step might be social media and a conference presentation, and then the interest stage might be that they read a data sheet and two blogs. Then you might have a comparison with the competition and so on. It's so all of this, for marketers, this all fits to content opportunities. Now, boy, I know a lot of people who've built the perfect solution to a real problem in our world as developers. It saves us time, it helps us work easier, and this probably also sounds familiar to you. I've fallen into this trap myself. You know, hey, I know this. Now I'm going to get my product exactly perfect, and then I'm going to just like put it up there, and everybody's going to come because it's so obviously great. People don't. That doesn't work, right? So the last sort of problem area that we're addressing when we're talking about creating communication to promote and sell your product, your services, is that, and we encounter this when we come into organizations, the product owner and the lead developer and the front-end developer and the UX designer and the ideal client and whoever else is involved in the process, right? They see all these different parts of it, and they might not really have a unified vision of what the product actually is, right? And there's an old Chinese parable or something about, you know, someone's holding the tail and someone's holding the tusk and so on. So we want to create this, unified vision around what the product is, what it does, what value it delivers, to whom. Yeah. Back when it wasn't my job, I've experienced a lot of positioning exercises where some way too expensive external expert comes in and says, I think that you're a Twitter with a marketplace. And someone else, no, we're not really that. And I think you're a this with a that plus a that. And all this top-down positioning and throwing spaghetti against the wall and seeing what sticks, right? And that's really a waste of time because we have built a technology. We know what it's made of, right? So I want to show you a way not to do this. We also don't play buzzword bingo at my company. Like, I'm not going to put NFT or blockchain or whatever next year's word in your marketing is just to attract people. That's not honest and that's not clear and that doesn't build trust, right? So, developers. Feature in this thing, and here's another thing, and it follows this standard, and so we used to use my business partner as the marketing persona for a CMS client because she came straight out of having an MBA. She has no technical background. She didn't know about technology in the old days, and she would go to a typo3.org, to a drupal.org, to a what have you, and the CMS, the open source CMS people would say, obviously we support UTF-8 character sets and bidirectional languages, and there's a WYSIWYG editor, and you can do drag and drop this, and then there's automatic image optimization for ba ba da ba ba da bum ba da bum. Right now, I think we understand as developers that when you put all those things together, you have a customizable authoring experience, and you can plug in Seek Editor or Aloha Editor back in the old days or whatever, right? And you understand, okay, it's modular. She just sees this, and it makes as much sense as that, right? Now, at the same time, right, where is the slide for that? Right, well, at the same time, right, Adobe, instead of doing this, Adobe Web Experience Manager would say, business-friendly authoring, right? So if you don't know about CMS, how can you possibly compare all those tiny little things with this giant statement and understand, there's no apples to apples, oranges to oranges comparison there, right? And it's a huge problem in technology communication, how to do this. And so this is potentially friendly to developer audiences, and the other one is sort of good for business audiences, but maybe not as honest as I'd like. So we thought about this problem for a long time. And you have to start with, as it says here, strong and clear consensus-based technical foundation. We want to build content based on the technical truth of your product, and I know I'm repeating myself, the business value that it delivers to whoever your audience is. And here's how we think about that. We run workshops and interviews with as many different stakeholders as we think is meaningful, both with clients and users, if there are any, with executives and salespeople looking down onto the product, also with the developers and product owners and people who write in the middle of all of the details. And we start to collect anything that looks like a feature, and a feature is a thing that does a thing. You could do this with a partner program, you could do this with a content management system, you can do this with any bit of technology, any service, anything in the end. We do it with tech. So each feature we say, hey, let's stick with authoring experience because it's easy for me to follow along. Here we support UTF-8 character sets. Good, so we can support multilingual stuff, right? And then there's probably a given WYSIWYG editor and spell checking and web image optimization and so on. So all of these things, we write a very simple bit of communication that says what this thing is, what it does, and a hint at what sort of value it delivers, right? So UTF-8, I can represent many languages well on the screen. We do a logical functional grouping of these things into feature areas. And at that point, we call it something, right? So this one is going to be authoring experience. And then a tagline is, I mean, I wouldn't use business-friendly authoring, right? But there's a concept for it, right? And then I write what we call a value case, and this is a nice trick to help do great communications consistently. The value case says, what's the benefit of this bit of feature, this feature area? What's the challenge it addresses, and how do you solve it, right? So, authoring experience, how do I benefit from that? I get more consistent, you know, the people who live in the back end of my website have a better experience every day, right? And the challenge is, instead of using disparate systems or hoping that their eyes catch all their spelling mistakes or not being able to do all the languages, right, we totally do it, and the solution is roughly, this really depends, but the solution is, you know, in this case, because there's these things in it, as we go up a little bit in this information hierarchy, that solution becomes a little clearer and a little easier to put together, right? So internally, we call these feature areas and feature categories in our pyramid. That doesn't matter. They are groups of N features that do things together. But you'll see that a feature category is one or more feature areas that come together, and we do exactly the same thing again. Now here, if I have authoring experience, and then I have another feature area that is something like digital asset management, right? And then maybe I have another area which is social media integration, right? All of a sudden I have a feature category that I might want to call digital marketing enabled. Oh, that's cool. And then you can say, because I do the things in the feature areas, therefore, right, there's a value case there, you know, you get this benefit. It helps you do all your marketing planning in one place and the execution, whatever. And we solve that by this and this and this in our, having this in our product. Now, I don't know whether you'll notice or not, but as marketers, right? So, well, there's several benefits here. Because we've interviewed the different stakeholders, right? The things that are important to the product owner and the things that are important to the developers and the things that are important to a given end client, right? They might be all different, but when people start to see this thing coming together, they're like, oh yeah, and don't forget that, and don't forget that. So, first of all, we're de-siloing the information. I don't know, I've worked at a place where the founder was also the genius and had everything in their head, right? We're also doing this to get that out of their head and make them repeatable and let them go and do other things, right? So we de-silo all this information, and then as marketers, well, if I'm writing technical articles, if I'm creating a data sheet for the technical people, where does my data sheet come from? It comes from right there. And how do we organize it? I organize it under each of those headers. And then whatever standards you follow, whatever libraries you plug in, whatever else, it's listed in here. Bop, 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 bop. Data sheet. Done. If I'm planning a marketing campaign, right, and I have feature areas and feature categories, let's say there's something else in the market that does something similar to what we do. So, I mean, I live in the CMS world a lot, so obviously Typo3, Drupal, Joomla, WordPress, Sulu, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If I'm comparing my open source CMS to Adobe Web Experience Manager, Web Experience Manager can do integrations with all of the Adobe Creative Suite. I can't do that with Drupal or Typo3, not easily. So when I have all of these, we can tag them with a marketing priority, we can tag them with a version number, we can tag them in all sorts of ways, and all of a sudden what we have is, well, these are our top three priorities, and these are our sales goals for the year, let's write about these three things. All of a sudden, it's a marketing campaign generator, and it's a content ideation tool, because you know that this area of functionality does these things. Go get a case study that proves it. Do you have documentation that supports that? You can check yes or no. You can hang that onto this, right? So all of a sudden, you have this kind of, not infinite, but you have a very large catalog of ideas. You can also say, if you tag these with a version number and you upgrade to the next version, you can go back and look what content you've created under a given version number and say, ooh, we better go check these 7 blogs and these 10 tutorials because they were from version 15 and now we've moved to 15.5 or 16.1 or whatever. So super powerful to have all this in one place together. And what we do with it early on is when we think we've got all of these things put together, the information is more and more concentrated, right? So when you get to these things, product solution statements, this is, we solve this problem for that persona, right? It's like a micro value case. It's a way to think of going out to market, like who you're going to be addressing, right? Unique selling points, positioning statement, product tagline, right? So all of this comes together, and you can do versions of it for competitive analysis, you know, by comparing that to your competition. And what the problem that we were solving for ourselves when we created the value map was, in fact, how do you compare two CMSs that describe themselves in completely different terms at completely different scopes and scales, right? So we broke it down in this way so that we're in control of the namespaces and the scope. And that's how we do that, and it's turned into all these other great things. So when we have this value map, yes. So here's the other thing that I think is utterly fascinating. Who's aware of the DIKW paradigm? Oh wow. Okay. Great. Data, information, knowledge, wisdom. So we made this whole value map thing and have applied it and helped customers with it. In all sorts of ways. All the blog planning I was talking about, all the data sheets. A client of mine 3 weeks ago, his main investor called and said, hey, I have to go present this to the board. Give me a one-pager about your product. And my client was like, no problem. And the guy said, hey, I know that's tough. You know, can you have it to us by next week? He's like, I can have it to you by tonight. And he went to his value map. Boom, boom, boom. What's the most important thing? Who's the persona that investor is interested in? They put it all together. So the thing that you have here that I've only realized recently is, I think it is a version of a known and tested information organization thing called the DIKW pyramid. So you collect data, all the data, and it's just information, right? So we collect features with this idea of what it is, what it does. We put that all together, and we start thinking, okay, you know, we have experience as technologists. Our clients are, you know, experts in their field. They put all of this context, and we agree on how to group these things together. This data, with the context of its groupings and its purpose, becomes information in this paradigm. Then, adding our expertise as communicators and the, you know, the market information that we see, we turn this into knowledge. So we've taken data and we've turned it into very strong, simple USP bullet points and statements about what it is, what it does, who it's for, and we can really use all of that. So that's all in this framework. That's also all in the past, they say. And then the wisdom part, data, information, knowledge, wisdom. What do you do with this? What is the wisdom? So once we can see all of this, it's pretty powerful, because we can say, hey, as I hinted at, if we're no good at integrating with Adobe Creative Suite, then we shouldn't market against that, and we should not write stuff about it, and we don't have to waste time on it. No problem. We can choose our content. We can establish our priorities. We can answer a lot of questions. We can also see things like, so if you see the answer questions and the update roadmap part, there's one more bit about this that's not necessarily obvious. Anywhere where you start and go upwards, right, you are going from something that's in there to why you do it. Now there's a separate bit that you can't see inside of here, and if you're familiar with like Sparkle queries and data triplets, right? Imagine a user story that says, "I am a golf club. I'm a scheduling manager at a golf club, and I have more members. Like all of my members can't play at the same time. Therefore, I need scheduling functionality, right? So you have a persona in an organization type with a business challenge. And that triplet can be answered by calendaring, time conflict resolution, automatic shifting of appointment slots and whatever in a set of features and features, right? And then, so my features in that case, why do we work on that? Because, boop, up there, there's somebody who needs that scheduling functionality. And at the same time, if a golf club manager is looking for a scheduling tool and that you go from the top down in this, yes, we do that. How do you do it? How do you do it? How do you do it? And this comes to what I said at the beginning. This is your technical truth. There's no vaporware here. There's no bullshit. There's no making promises that you can't keep. You're creating marketing and sales materials, answering questions based on your technical truth, right? So as I go up here, doing like that, if I'm creating content for this room from the developer's perspective, I can create content with this idea of the value that it delivers to the business person. And you say, oh, boss, I want to download this new open source tool because it looks super cool to play with, you know, or I want to buy this other thing and get a license for it. And they're like, super cool to play with is not enough good enough reason for me to spend money on it. But if you say, oh, but it will help you work faster, be more efficient, do better updates, blah, whatever it is, we can write content for technical roles as influencers that includes all the technical truth, all of the interfaces, all the stuff that we care about as developers, plus these ideas of the business value that it's delivering, right? And if we write or create a 3-minute overview video for the executive persona, right? Looking down on this with the product tagline and 3 USPs and like, call us about this, and it's right, something you can watch over a coffee. If that executive is interested in that, a decision maker, a budget holder is interested in that, they can say, oh, this looks great, and boy, I wish I had that. Go to the senior developer and ask her, hey, in this 3-minute video, they say they do this and this and this. Tell me if it's true and how they do that. And because we base this on your technical truth and we publish it all, no matter how much due diligence you do, it's all true all the way down, right? So we're able to create accurate and compelling content by thinking about it this way and planning it together. So this is super powerful. And you can find things like, hey, when you have this in the database, here's a feature that doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't attach to a business case. It's not, do we need to be spending money on that, right? And if you get a client that says, you solve this problem for me, and we don't know how it works inside that pyramid, we definitely have a gap in our value map, right? This is a super powerful organizational tool. Coming to the content piece of this, if I have, let's see how this slide works. Right. So from the pyramid, here we have some features. And then some of the challenges from the value cases that we've pulled out, and we're thinking about, okay, we're going to do an article for, so this is how we work, structured and repeatable quality content. You should do this when you're creating content. You know, who's your target audience? What's their pain point, right? Those come from the challenges. What are your business goals? Sell more widgets, I guess, right? So we capture this idea of, you know, we want to, you know, something in manufacturing. The brand message is what you want people to understand about your business without us necessarily writing it in explicit words. Here's the goal of the piece. Here's our outline. And straight from the value map, we can essentially automatically populate the brief and the article outline. And then as writers, we already know where we're going. We can do enough research to glue that all together. As an editor, I can say, hey, super nice draft, but you forgot challenge 3 or feature 2 under challenge 2 or something, right? And it's a super checklist feature, and you have all of this collected, and it's all true enough for your team to have approved it, right? Here is a real web page on a real website promoting Typo3 CMS. Another structural tool that we use is thinking about bits of communication components, right? How they fit together to make something like a landing page. So from what I showed you before, you'll notice benefit, challenge, solution statements come from the value cases. Those are the sub pieces of the value case that I was talking about before. Calls to action, calls to value, all that marketing stuff, right? Positioning, that comes from the value map if you have it in there. So then to create a landing page rather than a blog, you know, you can pretty much think about it as, hey, our taglines go in these places, positioning statement at the top of the page. You know, here's a value case broken down into three paragraphs, and those orange bullets, then they're like specific features. And this is very placative, it's very dull, it's not very creative, right? But all of this stuff, because you've captured it, it's like boom, 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 it's all there. And then you can go make it pretty, or you can synthesize a paragraph out of, you know, two sentences to still make the, or what have you, right? You can still be a word artist if you want to do that. 15? Okay. I'm going to be done so soon, unfortunately. So this really helps us do structurally important communication. And once you have this in place from your value map, you can send your authoring team through it and make it prettier. You can send your SEO team through and change the word widget to the word whatever, because that's the people, you know, you can do all of your regular marketing work on this coming out of a canonical source of truth. Then let's see, here's another example. This is a, oh right, marketing campaign management, right? So components, clearly a name, clearly some kind of value case, clearly some kind of feature statements, right? Yes. So just larger and larger versions of, you know, larger type of the things that I was saying before. So having the information captured in one place, and developers agreed on it, salespeople agreed on it, UX people agreed on it, clients agreed on it. Everybody has had a go at this and pulled it apart and looked at it, and everybody agrees that it's real and true. It means that you can feed your sales team real stories and tell them what not to say and tell them what to say. As marketers, you can target the people with the things that are really interesting to them. And as I was pointing out before, this is a really nice framework to say, hey, we need, you know, tutorials for these five things because they're not there yet. And also, well, not only tutorials, you have a catalog of the features and the functionality, right? So then you can, however it is you do your documentation, your tutorials, what have you, it's also there supporting you. You can also build it right in. So the impact that this has on product adoption is that we find sales teams telling better stories. Selling better stories, right? Less of that. And because you're being clear, and because no matter if they go up or down or sideways, this is based on the technical truth, right? The more they look into you, the more they should be able to tell that this is real and true, right? And throw a couple of case studies, you know, linked from whatever pages to, you know, show that clients also feel the same way. And, you know, you should make it easier for people to self-qualify and come to yes with you and ask for a demo or buy it and so on. So as I was saying, you can turn this into all sorts of communications, and whatever your style is, whatever your funnel is, if you need good documentation, it's there. The documentation is backed up by blogs, stories about your expertise, case studies, and you know, by being clear about what you don't do, if it's important, right? People can also self-qualify out, which is good because they don't waste your sales team's time, they don't waste their own time, there's no bad feelings developed. So it's a clearer, faster, more honest process. And repeating myself now, but I think we've seen, it's not part of the value map design, but we've seen teams come together to build the value map where there's been a slightly larger organization, or like the business and the technical sides of the house aren't the best friends. When we pull all of this together, we've even seen like people realize that they're all on the same team, and that the product, everybody agrees in the end, our product is this and we're going in this direction together, right? Instead of like, oh, but I think it's a this, but I think it's a that. It's I've seen it work a couple of times as this incredible like team building tool, right? It's amazing. But also, you just have this place where you've agreed on the language, you've agreed on what it is, you've agreed on what it does, and how to talk about it, right? And you have this catalog of pretty good texts that you can then wordsmith and refine and so on into whatever materials you need. So that's a superpower in terms of all the communications that you need to build in your organizations. And I think that as technical audiences, I think, I don't know, I didn't feel respected all the time in the past. I saw my business partner being deeply confused by different people trying to tell her different stories about how to solve the web publishing problem. And I was embarrassed to be at organizations where, frankly, the sales and marketing that was coming out wasn't really right, you know? And so I've spent the last 7 years with my business partner solving that and coming to this point where we can create compelling and technically accurate communication. And I just told you how we do it because I think it's really important that you're all able to do it, because I think the clearer we are about our technologies, the more, right, the more everyone can get out of it. Whew, thank you so much for inviting me here. That was it. I know it was a lot. I'm super happy to take questions later or whenever it comes through. Super happy to send you slides if you want. Are there any questions now? Sure, okay, yep. Great. And I realize I'm standing between you and coffees or beers at this point, so, you know. Thank you to the organizers. It's been really, really cool to be here and meet a new community. And yeah, thanks again.